the fruit. Adam and Eve took that fruit, my friends, and it launched the entire world into corruption. It launched the entire world into ruin, into slavery and sin. That's why you and I, we sin every day. See that? The reason why people die, my friends, is not because of the environment. It's not because of global warming. Stop blaming the environment for your sin, no. The reason why people die, my friends, is because of what? Sin. Sin, my friends. The reason why people trip and fall on scooters, what? Sin. The reason why people die is because of sin, diseases, famine, sir, starvation, racism, all these things, all these evils that are plaguing the world, all these things. The reason why this universe is soaked in sin is because of what? Because of our rebellion against God. And all Adam and Eve did, my friends, they took of the forbidden fruit, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and it threw the entire universe into chaos, into ruin. That's why I sin, man. That's why you sin. That's why we all sin. And that's why the Bible says we drink down iniquity like water. So your problem, my friends, is not some environmental thing. It's not some education thing. It's not that your next door neighbors are a problem, okay? The greatest problem in the world, okay, is not education, it's not taxes, it's not the border being closed off to Mexicans, okay? It's not racism, it's not a political issue. Your greatest problem is what? Your sin before God. Your sin.
They saying, thus saith your maker, thus saith God. And the Bible commands all men everywhere to repent and be reconciled to God. Yes, sir, you can be reconciled to your maker. Are you? Are you, sir? Because the Bible says this, each and every one of us are born as enemies of God. Born as enemies of God, born separated from God, my dear friends. We're born, the Bible says in the book of Colossians, we're hostile to God. He's talking to believers who have been reconciled, that we were born alienated from God, sir. Hostile to God. Are you hostile to God? Do you reject God? Since the beginning, yes, bit. You said yes, sir.
Yes,
sir, you know on the day of judgment, your sin will find you out. Sin is pleasurable for a season, as it says in the book of Hebrews, but it's a fleeting pleasure, my dear friends. And on the day of judgment, it will find you out. Don't be deceived, your sin will find you out. And as I was saying, Jesus, right before he went to that cross, he gave a warning to society. He gave a warning to his disciples, my dear friends. He said, watch. Watch lest you be weighed down by the dissipations, drunkenness, cares of this life. And that day will come upon you suddenly like a trap. Fruit will come upon all who dwell on the face of the earth. Jesus said, watch lest you be weighed down by the world. What? Now, what's in the world, sir? The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. People live today as if they will live forever. You see, if your doctor, my dear friends, if your doctor told you, you have cancer and you're gonna die in a week, you know what you'll start thinking about? You'll start thinking about the God you've been ignoring, my dear friend. You'll start thinking about death. You'll start thinking about the important things of life. You'll start thinking about where you will spend eternity. But today, Jesus warned for you to be watchful, lest you be weighed down with this world and the lies that it offers you. Entertainment, a false God raised up in society today. Nothing sinful about it, my dear friends. But sometimes it's just silly. We ignore God and worship creation rather than the Creator. The Bible says in Romans 1, it's futile. It's futile. Although they knew God, it says they did not glorify Him as God or gave thanks to Him, but they became futile in their thinking and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images. Like a soccer ball. Images made like mortal men and birds and creeping things. Therefore, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. God gives you over to your sin. And that's why we're coming here to you today, my dear friends. I'm an ex-slave of sin like many of you here today. I'm an ex-slave of sin, born of the Spirit of God, born by Jesus Christ, my dear friend. Born by the Holy Spirit, but by faith in Christ. Coming here to you today to preach to you the everlasting gospel. The everlasting gospel, and it comes not from us or our opinions. It comes from Almighty God. And the Bible says this. You see, this message we've been entrusted with, we're ambassadors of Christ. It's as if God was making his appeal through us telling you, be reconciled to God. And this is the message of reconciliation. He, Jesus Christ, became sin who knew no sin so that we might become the righteousness of God. That's the message of reconciliation. That is the glorious gospel in which your soul can be saved today. That is the glorious gospel. He, Jesus, became sin. What does that mean, ma'am? Well, first of all, we need to recognize what sin is. Sin, the Bible says all have sinned, ma'am, and fallen short of the glory of God. Do you recognize that, sir? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You know, Charles Spurgeon once said, Charles Spurgeon, a famous preacher, he said, the word sinner rolls smooth off the tongue. It's easy to say. I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. Of course I'm a sinner. I'm not perfect. My friends, do you recognize how serious sin is? Not because of the acts you do, but because of the God you sinned against. God is the creator of the heavens and the earth, the stars, the seas, and the skies. He's the creator of all things, my dear friends. He's the one who literally owns the ground you walk on right now, sir, headed towards the game. Headed, for some people, headed towards idolatry, headed to worship another God. My dear friends, he's the one who owns all things. And God literally gifts us with every good thing we have in this life. Do you know that? The Bible says in the book of James, chapter 1, it says, do not be deceived, brothers. Every good gift comes from the Father of lights. Don't be deceived. Every good gift comes from the Father of lights. That means every time you take a sip of Gatorade, sir, it's a gift of God. It is a gift given to you. It is a gift, sir. And you know what we do with God's gift? We take his gifts, but we don't give him glory. We take his gifts and we reject his name. We take his gifts and say, God, I want your creation. I want the air that you hold together. H2O, I want the molecules you are holding together by the word of your power. But God, you know what? I don't want you in my life. That's what we do. That's what sin is. God, I don't want you. And that's what we do in our sin, my dear friends. That's what I do in my sin. We reject God and exchange him for the things he created, for the gifts, sir. Do you recognize that, man? So all sin comes from that mindset. All sin, my dear friends, come from the mind. Drunkenness, idolatry, adultery, fornication, blasphemy. It all comes from God. I hate you. I don't want you. Even if you think you don't hate God, my dear friends, if you're apathetic towards God, it's hatred in itself. It's hatred in itself because what do you have apart from his grace? What do you have apart from the grace of Almighty God? Nothing. What do we have, my friends? What do we have apart from God's grace? Zero, sir. Absolutely nothing. We have nothing apart from his grace. But we take his grace and don't give him glory. And every one of us have done that. Now the Bible says that deserves the justice and wrath of God. The wrath of God is coming towards sin. The Bible says Jesus Christ is coming. We'll roll up the heavens like a garment. And every eye is going to see him, my dear friends. And he's going to judge the world in righteousness. Now, what do we just find out from the scriptures? You're not righteous. We're sinners. And sinners is not some small thing. Me being a sinner up here is not some small thing. You being a sinner down there is not some small thing. It is the worst thing ever. It's the worst thing ever, my dear friends. You've sinned against the holy God, and the justice of God is headed towards your way apart from Christ. It's not funny, my dear friend, because my friend, God is not mocked. When your conscience, your own conscience even condemns you, that's why we laugh. We're actually convicted in our hearts. We know we've done some wicked things. I've done wicked things behind closed doors, and the eye of the Lord is on every place, beholding the evil and the good. And on the day of judgment, your sin will be exposed. But there's good news today. And that's the point, my dear friend. That's why we come out here, not to preach to you the bad news. We must preach that so you can understand the good news, my friends. You know what the good news, sir, is? The sin sinners have committed, Jesus Christ bore upon himself. Literally, it was expiated on him. It was placed upon him. The guilt, my friends, that we deserve to have, the guilt and the sin was laid upon Christ. Can you imagine? Can you imagine taking all of my sins? One person? I'm one person. Every time I lie, it's placed on you. Every time I steal, it's placed on you. You have to bear it. Can you imagine the sadness of that? And Jesus Christ bore the sins of all who would believe in him. They were placed on him. He became sin who knew no sin. the one who did not deserve to be crushed bore the wrath of God upon sin, my friends. My dear friends, he became sin.
That means if you would place your faith in him, your sins can be placed upon Christ.
He became sin on that cross. God did not see the perfect righteousness of Christ. What he saw, my friends, was the sin of sinners.
What does God do then?
He crushes Christ on the cross. The Bible says it is the will of God to crush him. Sir, why do you mock and walk away? Why don't you talk, sir? Come and talk. We don't bite. We don't bite, my dear friends. We want you to know this glorious gospel.
He became sin who knew no sin.
The one who lived perfect for 33 years became sin on the cross of Christ.
He became sin who knew no sin. Why? Why did he do that?
So that we sinners could be made right with God, can become the righteousness of God. What does that mean? See, on the cross, Christ bore sin. So when we place our faith in Jesus, when we place our faith in Christ, you know what we get? You know what we get, sir? The blood of Christ wiping away all your sins. The righteousness of Christ cloaking you.
Why? Many people say, just as if I've never sinned. Imputed righteousness can be... The righteousness of Christ can be applied to you by faith alone, my friends. That's your... It can be a gift. It's a gift. It's a free gift. A free gift.
You don't earn gifts, sir, right? You don't earn gifts. Christ did it. It's a gift of God, but you must receive it by faith, man. Okay, have you received it, sir? Receive Jesus Christ by faith.
Repent of your sins that put him on that cross. It's not works plus faith, my dear friends. It's a repentant faith to you. Islam can't save you. Buddhism can't save you. Muhammad can't save you. Hare Krishnaism can't save you. Confucius can't save you. Only the Lord Jesus Christ can save you today.
Why? Why? Because all of those other religions seek to place a burden of the law on you. A burden of the law that you have failed to keep. They seek to establish their own righteousness, being ignorant of God's righteousness.
Don't be ignorant of God's righteousness. God is holy, man. God is holy. He's holy.
The cherubim and seraphim surround God's throne saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory.
You know, John, who laid upon the bosom of Jesus, saw him and fell at his feet as though dead. What do you think you're going to do?
My brother Leonard Ravenhill said, when he lived, what do you think you're going to do when you see Jesus high and lifted up?
His eyes like flame of fire. His tongue sharper than any double-edged sword. His feet like burnished bronze. His hair as white as wool.
That tongue is for his enemy.
That sword is for his enemies.
The word of God is sharper than any double-edged sword. And when the books are open, you'll be judged by this word.
Lest you perish in the way, it says. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish in the way. What is that anger? God's wrath. And on the day of judgment, it will be exposed before society. This earth is going to melt away. That Mercedes-Benz Stadium, if it doesn't get done away with earlier, it will melt. At
God's wrath, my friends, it will melt. The day of the Lord, the book of Malachi says, shall come hot like an oven, and all the evildoers will be put to stubble, it says. The day of the Lord will come hot like an oven. Are you ready for that day, man? What are you going to do with your sin on that day? Is it applied to Christ, or is it applied to you? Because if it's applied to you, that fire is headed towards your way, my friends. God's wrath separates you from God, my friends. He, when he beholds your sin, his wrath is kindled.
Now Christ came into the world to take away both your sin and God's wrath. The Bible said, John said, when he saw Jesus, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Taking away the sin of the world. Why? Because he became sin. He became the sacrifice, the substitute. He was substituted in our place. For those who have faith in him, sir, Jesus was substituted. If you would have faith in him, that could be yours. He's our substitute. He became sin. And our sin has been dealt with. And also God's wrath has been dealt with, my friends. God's wrath. Because what happened? The Bible says in Isaiah 53, it was the will of the Lord. In other translations, says it pleased God to crush him. To crush Christ.
You see, we ask the question sometimes, who killed Jesus? What do you guys think? Who killed Jesus? Do you guys know? Do you guys care?
don't even care about the everlasting gospel these days. Who killed Jesus?
Who killed Jesus, sir? Was it Romans? Was it Jews? Ultimately, my dear friends,
the humanity of Christ was slaughtered on the cross by God the Father.
God the Father crushed the Son of God. Why? Because his love is pointed towards sinners who would have faith in him, my dear friend. His love, his everlasting love, and his steadfast love could be experienced because of what Christ did on that cross.